butchering her name, so you might want to help me. But Shiva.
Yeah, anyway. So the name is easy, so let's get the name right.
Get the name right.
Because, you know, it's not that hard. It's Iadore.
Iadore.
Like how you would say Iadore.
Iadore.
Yeah.
Yes, okay.
Yeah.
All right. So Shiva Iadore, there we go, got it, is here to speak to us about his campaign. And he is running against his war.
It's what's
Warren.
Her name?
Warren.
And another one.
Not Idora.
And another one.
There's
Jeff,
several candidates.
Jeff Deal.
No, we know, but Shiva is here to speak. We'll translate people in. I have a whole chart here in case people get confused. Welcome.
Great, thank you for having me. How many people are here with the Groton RTC?
Most of us.
Okay, great.
Much
so, you know, I know I want to talk about this free speech thing that you guys were just talking about. You know, it's unfortunate not one Republican was at that free speech event. Right, this was about free speech. So after the event, everyone was passing proclamations and these kinds of things, but no one ever gets their hands dirty. And I think you were addressing that. So what I'm talking about is, I don't know if you know, I was one of the keynote speakers at that event. And we took our lives into our hands. And so did the Boston police. Marty Walsh did, Charlie Baker did. They branded it as a Nazi event, and I'm a brown-skinned Indian guy, and I was called a Nazi, and a white supremacist event. So what I want to discuss with you today is basically have an open discussion about truth and what we really stand for. You know, the founders of this country, one of the founding principles was the First Amendment. Was it not? And the First Amendment was not just about free speech, it was about truthful free speech. So I'd like to put forward a concept called true free speech. The Constitution and the Supreme Court has ruled, and I know this personally, that when you say something, every one of us has a right to say whatever we want, and the First Amendment was put in place so you and I, as citizens, could go write stuff against our government. That was the original ethos of it, or the philosophy behind it. Starting in the 50s, corporations started also getting free speech rights, multi-billion dollar companies, media companies. And the interesting thing is a media company could write anything. And if you didn't have the wherewithal to fight them, they could get away with character assassination. Now I know this personally because I took on Gawker Media when they refuted the facts that I was the inventor of email, when it went into the Smithsonian. I'll come back to that. But free speech is something that I've actually put my life on and fought for. And on August 19th, you know, 2 months before that, I was asked to speak at that event by some amazing young kids, 17-year-old, 15-year-old high school students, and some college students who really felt that we need to have a much more spectrum of conversation in this country beyond just branding people with white hats or people with a swastika as white supremacists. And that's what's happened. Academic elites have narrowed the discussion of what is a white supremacist, but they don't expose a lot of other white supremacists that take place in academia. For example, no one ever questions why people get on the stage with Jimmy Carter, who said that we need ethnically pure neighborhoods. I don't know if you know that. Carter said that. No one ever brings up Hillary Clinton as a white supremacist who called black children super predators, right? So the point I'm saying is that what occurred on August 19th is extremely telling, and Republicans should be ashamed for branding that as a white supremacist event. And after that, Jeff Deal and Marty Lamb want to get their name out there by attacking BLM. These are all politicization of an event so they can get kudos. When they didn't put their butt out on the line, which is what I did and 40 other people did that, and the police put their butt on the line, and they were the ones who were thrown urine at by Antifa and others. So what I want to talk to you about is I'm an outsider to all of this, and I figured out the racket over the last 120 days, how people get into this state convention, right? You have to get delegates. And that's why I asked who here are part of the delegates, because we figured out that there's no way they want us to get on the ballot. Took me about 120 days to figure this out. We've been very naively going to all the RTCs with our bus, giving great talks. We get either standing ovations or people really love what we have to say. But you have three insiders running, and you know, I'm the outsider. I'm the guy who actually has created jobs, came here as an immigrant as a 7-year-old kid with nothing, as a low caste untouchable from India. And my parents left India because they didn't believe in a caste system. They believed that this country was a country where you get into positions by what you do. Meritocracy, right? Not who you are. Or not you know, who you know. It was about what you did. Isn't that what it was all about? The founders of this country, they weren't career politicians. They were blacksmiths, they were soldiers, Washington was a surveyor. You go down the list, these people actually had skills. And their notion of governance was that you participate and then you exit, you go back to the farm. It wasn't supposed to be a career. Being a senator is not a career. It's an honor that you get to serve this country and then you're supposed to go back and work. But what we've created now is career politicians. Beth Lindstrom included, Kingston gives a lot of money, Jeff Deal obviously. So what I want to ask you is, are you guys ready? Is the Republican Party really ready for someone like me? And you need to really ask that. Because I'm the guy who actually knows how to create jobs. I know about education. I've been to MIT. Debbie Nightingale's over there. Debbie was the head of the systems group at MIT. Debbie's known me for 30 years. Creepy's there. He's a student at MIT. Dr. Kishore, I don't know where he is. You know, he's the guy who came up with a solution for the opioid treatment and was attacked and thrown in jail for 8 months by Martha Copley because his solution went against methadone clinics and rehab. So we actually have a lot of solutions. But crony capitalists and the politicians don't want solutions out. And you're talking to someone who has a degree in biological engineering, who's created right now a biotech company that's worth many billion dollars. I've created multiple software companies. And I believe I'm the right representative for you, for the people of Massachusetts. But the system is set up in our own party where Charlie Baker hasn't yet to meet with me. Where, you know, as we understand, he's got other maneuverings going on here. So when my parents came here in 1970, we settled in Paterson, New Jersey, one of the poorest cities in this country. I went through the public education system. Went to Clifton, then Parsippany, then Livingston. So my parents didn't have school choice in those days. They just kept moving to the better public school systems. So in 7 years, we moved to 4 public school systems. By the time I was 14, I had finished calculus. And that was because, as a 9th grader, because the teachers in that time, before the unions took over and disempowered teachers, actually gave me the core curriculum, and I could do something beyond that. So by the time I was 14, I also went to NYU in a special computer science program where 40 students in the United States got selected. This was in 1978. Everyone remember, a computer would fit the size of this room, right? Women in those days essentially had 4 jobs. They could be a secretary, nurse, school teacher, what was the other one?
Librarian
or housewife, okay? And I was given a full-time job at a medical school. I would go over to Newark, New Jersey in the middle of high school, full-time job, and I was given a challenge. Everyone remember the old inter-office mail system where a secretary had an inbox, outbox, folders? Remember that? She'd write a thing called a memo, to, from, subject, carbon copy, put it in those pneumatic tubes. I was asked to convert that entire system to the electronic version as a 14-year-old kid. Only in America could this have occurred, and I called that system email. And 2 years later, I was given the first U.S. copyright for it, officially recognizing me as the inventor of email. I share that story with you because since 14, I've been working as a full-time job. I've always been working, even though I went to MIT after that, you know, 4 degrees, PhD, started 7 companies, it's always been working. And you look at these politicians, how many of them have actually worked and actually delivered jobs, know how to fix things, know what software engineering is, know what biotech is, know what it means to fire people. I would say probably none of them. So that's one part of my career. But the most important thing is I'm a fighter. And in order to be a fighter, not only do you need your tools of education, but you need to have an actual history of fighting. It's one thing for me to say it. You know, in 1981, when I came to MIT, You'll actually see pictures. If you go to my website, shivaforsenate.com, and go to the About Shiva page, you'll see me. I was a kid who burned the South African flag on the steps of MIT, because MIT had investments in South Africa. Remember, South Africa was apartheid in those days. Right? So this was liberal hypocrisy, an institution investing in South African apartheid. I was the one to organize the food service workers and make sure they got better wages. I was the one to make sure more poor whites, poor women got into MIT. These are all, and you can go look at it, it's documented. During my PhD graduation, I was a student who took up a sign that said US out of Iraq, because I didn't believe it was appropriate for, you know, our soldiers to be fighting a war that was essentially making a few people wealthy. It was essentially a war, had nothing to do with protecting our freedom. So that's as a young kid. In 2007, after I got my PhD, I went to India on a Fulbright. Everyone know what a Fulbright is? You get to do research. And after I was leaving India, I was nominated by the Prime Minister of India to run the largest innovation center. Huge, prestigious appointment. Highest level scientist position, get a huge bungalow in Delhi. I took that position on because I said, hey, let me help India out. And within 6 months, I figured out the racket. There's massive corruption in this institution. I could have just sat quietly there, treated like royalty. Instead, I wrote a report which exposed the corruption in India. And after death threats, I had to leave India now. And eventually, 3 years later, I was invited back by the Prime Minister of India, honored as a serial entrepreneur of the year. So I fought India, exposed it, and took on my life in many ways to do that. 4 years ago, everyone know Monsanto? Do you know what they do? Mm-hmm. They create pesticides. They're the ones who did Agent Orange. Elizabeth Warren, by the way, supported the Monsanto Protection Act, which allows the executive branch to overrule federal judges if the federal judge finds that there's something wrong with any type of crops that actually hurt human life. So if a federal judge imposes an injunction on Monsanto, the executive branch can overrule. It was passed during Obama's administration. Warren supported this. There's a lot of people in Western Massachusetts who are into yoga or into organic food who think they're going to support her, but when they hear that I was a guy who wrote 5 research papers, exposed it, and then in fact offered Monsanto my $10 million building in Cambridge if they could disprove it. It went viral on the internet. You can read about it. 2011, my dear mom was dying of pulmonary fibrosis. It's a horrible disease. You have like 3 months to live. In a beautiful suitcase, she had saved all those artifacts, remember I talked about from the invention of email. I never made a penny off that. Never wanted fame or fortune from it. And Time magazine came and looked at all this, and they wrote a great article called The Man Who Invented Email. You can read about it. November 2011. 3 months after that, the Smithsonian wanted all my materials and went into the Smithsonian. And you would think that should be an occasion for essentially it's the epitomization of the American dream. Instead, what happened was Gawker Media wrote an article calling me all sorts of names, defaming me. But I didn't sit still. I kept fighting. Last year, we fought Gawker and we won a major settlement, $750,000, and the 3 defamatory articles were pulled down. So you're looking at a guy who will fight, and then you have this free speech thing. And we're not going to let them get away. We're not going to pass proclamations. You're going to see some lawsuits being issued. So do we really want someone who will fight for you, who's willing to risk his life for you? Or do we just want another politician? Because it's the safe thing to do. It's really up to you. It's really up to you. But I can tell you this, that my parents didn't leave India to create a neo-caste system in this country, and that's what we're evolving to. We have a set of elites, academic elites, political elites, and media elites, who are determining what is truth, right? What is speech? While they get away with all sorts of fake speech. So what I'm here to ask you for is to really ask yourselves, is the Republican Party really ready to be inclusive and really live up to what its original core foundation was and what the founders were about? Or do you guys just want to crank through another state convention? You know, I know all you guys know each other. And just do another thing again. Because Donald Trump's winning, whether you like him or not, was a necessary disruption. It was a necessary disruption that needed to take place. And I'm talking to you as a systems guy. And now it's opened up opportunities for truth, for people to make bigger decisions. And that's what I'm here for, because I don't need to be doing this. I can't be bought at all. You know, a lot of people running in here are looking to get, win governor, line their pockets with PAC money. That's what's going on. And we're going to win this election against Warren, because if I'm put on a stage with her, there's no chance that she has of winning. Because it's going to be really clear to people who the real Indian is and who the fake Indian is. Any questions? Yeah.
Let's talk about a few issues. For example, health care. Do you believe that we should be going towards a Medicare for all or whatever
single payer
type system? There's actually conservatives that are talking about this now as a viable alternative, and that we should be the ones framing that as opposed to letting the Democrats frame it. What do you think about that?
Yeah, so there's three things, you know, so I want to talk about real health, real education, real jobs. Let's talk about healthcare. So you used the word healthcare, right? Before I answer that, let's really define what healthcare is. We have this, no one ever has questioned what is healthcare. What we really have right now, to be precise about it, is not healthcare. We have two guys, Obama and Romney, it's really Romney Care. What it actually created was a front end for insurance companies to get a captive audience. Obamacare / Romney Care is basically supports big insurance. I don't know if you guys really look at this.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do with health. What it has done is made each one of us forced to get insurance. And that insurance, if you actually go read it very carefully, how insurance companies operate, insurance companies have created big drug buying deals with big pharma and also big services deals with big hospitals. So we now have actually big insurance, big pharma, and big hospitals all in a triangle of collusion. It has nothing to do with health. What it has to do is a form of health care called crisis management. The modern healthcare system actually came out of the Crimean War, when if you trace the history of Florence Nightingale, she wasn't a nurse. The men have done a great job in reducing her to just being a nurse. Florence Nightingale was actually a member of the Royal Society of Statistics. She was the first person who did big data. She was the first person who put together the fact that soldiers were not dying because of being shot on the battlefield, but because when they came to the hospital, there was no care. So she's the one who created the whole concept of hygiene. She had this vision, a 200-year vision, that if we created hospitals where people were taken care of, you'd have clinical research, et cetera. So, and the goal was to put that soldier back on the battlefield after they'd been shot, okay? So what we have now is a form of health care which is about crisis management. It's about after you get a chronic disease, after you get into a catastrophe, then I'm going to give you knives, which is invasive, or drugs. Right, so let's just frame that. And no one discusses this, and I can, because I've been pursuing health and doing research in health, believe it or not, since I was about 7 years old. My grandmother was a traditional medical healer in India, practicing traditional systems of Indian medicine, where she could understand what was going on in your body by observing your face, using non-invasive methods. That's what led me in my journey to do medical research. So I know this I don't need consultants to tell me this. So when we want to look at healthcare, we all have to understand that we don't have healthcare. We have insurance care that's based on crisis management. So whether we put in, you know, universal medical care or universal health care, what it's really going to fundamentally do is make big insurance or, you know, big pharma richer and big hospitals wealthier.
So what's your answer?
The answer is you've got to focus on two aspects here. One is you have to look at prevention. First of all, we need to have a whole holistic plan to this. We need to go in and we need to recognize that 80% of the payouts that healthcare companies do is for chronic disease, many of them which can be prevented, for example, type 2 diabetes, with proper nutrition, proper diet, proper exercise, which people need to learn at a much earlier age, much, much earlier. You need to have much more broader support for an entrepreneurial insurance model where insurance companies, for example, could exist that can offer a whole array of preventative services, and then you can get crisis management as you need, okay? And those crisis management can also be converted to other types of policies, like an insurance policy or an investment model. And this is not new, it's been out there. So that's what we should be incenting, and that's what the policy should incent. Number one, prevention. I don't know if you, do you know how many people practice yoga now in the United States? Anyone know? Yes. 36 million people. Functional foods is going to be a $270 billion industry. Elon Musk's brother, he's started a whole organization called Eat.org, where the eating food is a $4.6 trillion industry, which is nearly the level of our national budget. We don't even know how to eat right. 46% obesity in the United States. No one addresses this. All the attention is on Obamacare, Romney Care. These things aren't going to solve health, guys. Like, so the Republicans and Democrats come up with issues that have nothing to do with the real issue, except creating these two sides which don't address the core issues. We need to address, and it starts with education. We need to address prevention. Crisis management, we should have a whole array of choice on where you can get that from. And that's how we actually address health care. Let me move on, to, if you don't mind.
No, go ahead. I'm not a total believer yet. But go on to your other...
On what? On prevention?
Yeah, I mean, because there's got to be a big brother that tells people how to do this stuff. No. Who's going to be the big brother?
No, you don't need a big brother. You make it much more innovative. You make it much more entrepreneurial. Right now, it is big brother.
Well, how are you going to incentivize? I hate that word, but sort of.
That's a fail word.
Okay.
It's a good word. Yeah.
Okay. Entrepreneurs who are looking for a return on their investment to support this. I understand how you get money into the insurance business.
Well, so do you agree there's two parts of healthcare? There's crisis management care and there's preventative care. There's not just, if you're defining healthcare as after you get sick, which is what the current model is.
Well, I look at healthcare as a duality as well, maybe a little different. Mm-hmm. Okay. I believe that you have from an insurance point of view, you have things that are truly accidental and fortuitous that make sense to insure. Okay, catastrophic, somebody gets in a car accident, cancer, some of these things that maybe, yes, in the law of large numbers, you can predict, but for an individual, you can't, okay? So that's one aspect of healthcare. The other aspect of healthcare is the lower level, the everyday level. That's really non-insurable. Insurers, it's very inefficient dealing with diet. It's very inefficient dealing with routine annual physicals and this kind of stuff because it's just dollar for dollar. It doesn't work as insurance. So to me, that's how you would approach.
Well, let's just take what you just said. If you take what you just said, right?
Yeah.
Right now, right, we don't have competition among insurance companies, right?
No.
Exactly. So if you made insurance companies...
Between states, they took it, the competition.
That's what I'm saying.
It needs to go back.
It needs to go back. States.
But that's just nonsense. We don't have competition between insurance companies?
No, not between states.
No,
that's
don't.
True. We don't.
That's what I'm trying to say.
Between states. Okay, if that's what you're saying.
Right.
Yes.
Within a state, it's a captive audience that you have. It's like, what other business has that? You know, it's like saying there's going to be three companies in a particular biotech field. That doesn't happen in any other industry. It's a racket.
Well, it's a racket because of the McCarran-Ferguson Act
But the reality is there's many other innovative models for doing insurance. And I can share some of them with you if you want right now or offline. But the reality is there's two types of health care. You're absolutely right, right? You cannot motivate people to be healthy. The reason I brought up the 36 million people who do yoga right now, because people are recognizing that their primary care physician, by the way, we've lost around 150,000 primary care physicians. My sister went to Harvard Medical School. She can't afford to be a doctor, she says, because of the regulation, right? So everyone joins big hospitals. So when you look at the reality of where you used to get health care was you used to see your doctor, he used to observe you, look at you. Now he's on the computer typing. This is a ground level reality. So none of these issues are ever addressed in any of these policies in Romney Care or Obamacare. So I'm saying you open up the architecture, you allow much more competition, so you can have many different flavors of crisis management care. And I think there's many innovative models which I can talk to you more. But then you have to support, because those insurance companies which engage in supporting prevention, because look, one of my best friends is the chief investment officer at the custodian company which supports nearly five of the large insurance companies. So I know the mechanics here. When you pay your premium, it never goes to the insurance company. It goes to a custodian company. They pool together all that money and they do investments of that. Now, their cost, so they're making X amount of dollars from all those investments. The payouts are three things. In three buckets, you can look at it, always separate from operations costs. Either your hospital visits, like you said, the major catastrophes, something accidental. But the majority of it, 80% is chronic care. So if you had open architecture on an insurance company, and I were able to start an insurance company where I just offered you crisis care, but I give you all these amazing tools for prevention, I bet you I could give you a lower insurance cost because I would prevent many of your preventable diseases in a much more holistic way, and I could basically essentially make more money and deliver you a lower premium. That model, these models are out there, but because we don't allow competition, those models never have gotten a chance to get out there. That's the incentive.
Yep. Gee, I'd like, if I could, interrupt for a minute. I think this healthcare conversation could really get down into the nitty-gritty and could continue on. But what I'm more interested in, and I think great points, you made great points. What I'm really interested in is I shudder a little bit when I hear somebody talking about, you know, the federal government controlling things like healthcare. I agree, healthcare is kind of muddled. Hey, really what we should be talking about is health insurance. But now you're kind of talking about a process where we actually, the federal government starts defining, you know, how health care is administered and things like that. And I kind of, as a Republican, as a conservative, I have a little bit of a problem with that. I can see regulating, you know, you don't want wacko ideas. Although I look at the food pyramid, which is, you know, back in, what is that called, the 80s and 90s?
It's completely wrong.
It turns out it's completely wrong. But, yeah, you know, we're told this is, you know, God, you're told that you should get, what, 70%
of nutrition. But the federal government shouldn't be involved in any of that.
Well, I want to kind of get your sense of that, because, you know, why is the federal government involved in that? You know, they should be like a top level, maybe some simple rules, like allowing commerce across state lines for insurance companies. And, you know, I think the uninsurables, people with cancer and things like that, you know, there needs to be some type of safety net for those people. But beyond that, let the private market, you know, sort it out and go after antitrust issues or where people are getting screwed. Maybe the federal government should do that. That's where I see it as. And I'm not hearing that. I'm hearing
First of all, you got to understand what you're talking about is what I'm saying. But if you start looking in the 1970s, pharma companies and big hospitals started getting involved in policy making. Go look at the history of that, starting around Carter's era.
No, I understand that.
Right,
but
what that has resulted in is big pharma and big hospitals dictating policy. That the outcome of that is Romney Care / Obamacare. That's what we have today.
So and how do we stop that? Do we want to stop that, or do we just continue making this bigger bottle? Do we expand the
region? Well, no, there's nothing to expand. The reason I gave the yoga example is that's occurred by everyday people figuring out what's right for them.
Mm-hmm.
There's no regulation of yoga. Regulation of nutritional supplements, there's none of that. People are figuring things out for themselves. And I'm saying those are good things. That's what should be incented. Those behavior things is what we should incentivize. What we have right now is big insurance of bureaucracy, which has created a modern healthcare system. Now, I don't know if you're saying you're for that, because
no, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying why do we have senators even talking about stuff like that?
Because right now we have a healthcare.
I understand what's going on now, but in the future, is that something that you feel
government
should be more involved?
No, what I'm saying is the federal government has been in a collusion because of the lawyers and lobbyists to create the modern quote unquote healthcare system.
Okay,
that's the result of it. Because of the massive influence of big pharma and big hospitals, this is what we have. Over here, everyday citizens are taking health into their own matters, and that's a good trend. The example I gave with yoga, or the example I gave with nutritional supplements, is people are saying, I'm going to go figure this out on my own. Those are all good things.
So what's the solution?
What I'm saying is we need more competition. The across state lines for insurance companies, should be, there should not be a restriction within a state only you can have X number of insurance companies. We need to have insurance models that allow much more entrepreneurialism. So it's not just a few insurance companies who are owning this.
So how big do you think this legislation should be? We've talked about a replacement for Obamacare.
First of all, Obamacare should be repealed, okay? Obamacare has nothing to do with health care. Mm-hmm. I keep coming back to that. It has to do with supporting big insurance. What Romney and Obama did was essentially made us, all of us, captive clients to big insurance companies.
So what goes in its place?
So you understand that RomneyCare was put in place because the free care pool in the state of Massachusetts was bankrupting Massachusetts. So the concept was that if you put everybody in the pool, then the people that were healthier and doing yoga would support the people that had more permanent or disabilities.
The reason is they never addressed the real issue, okay? The real issue is high drug prices and the cost of hospital care.
Well, those are two other issues.
No, those are the real issues. The reason that we do all of this nonsense is because when you actually look at how much we're paying for all of this stuff, it's way too much.
Right, and the large part of that is because of lawsuits. So are you going to...
Let's separate it into two different groups. A large part of this is the actual cost of medicine. Do you understand how long it takes to create a drug?
I have a master's in public health. I understand all of this.
So how long does it take to create a drug right now?
I don't know how many years, but it takes a number of years, and the deal is that many of them fail.
It takes 13 to 15 years.
Yeah, and many of them fail, so we're paying for the drugs that aren't even on the market.
That's not even the reason. Let me tell you why the cost of medicine and healthcare is so high. It takes 13 to 15 years to develop a single drug. And if you, Dennis, discovers a synthetic drug today, he goes, gets funding, he's got about 13 to 15 year timeline. 6-7 years to spend what's called preclinical trials, in test tubes and killing lots of animals. Then if he gets FDA allowance, he's got another 7 years of clinical trials. At the end of that, if he spent $5 billion, which is the upper number, $5 billion to create this drug, if that drug makes it through, guess how much time does he have to recoup on his investment? Patent life is 20 years. He's got 5 years. So if a drug can reach 100,000 people, divide his $5 billion by 100,000, he's got to charge, $500,000 or $50,000, $500,000 for that drug. It's a drug development cycle, okay? And the pharma companies own that process end to end. We need innovation in that. It's not regulation. It's going to be through innovation. One of the companies I recently built, Cytosolve, you can look it up, we built a way to model the human cell on a computer. It came out of my PhD work at MIT. In 11 months, we discovered a drug for pancreatic cancer and got allowance by the FDA. Okay? So I know about this stuff. It's not, all this other stuff is frankly not going at the reality that we don't let innovative processes get out there. So that's innovation. If you look at hospital care, the amount of hospital care because of the actuarial stuff that's happened, a friend of ours is a very close anesthesiologist. She says, Shiva, when I have to give pain meds, I see a patient with spinal surgery. I don't need to give him 3 shots of pain meds, but the protocol says I have to. That's being dictated by someone else in an actuarial group. So these issues are what's actually increasing the cost of healthcare. So we could, in fact, have quote-unquote universal healthcare. These are not the real issues. We're not going at the root cause of the problem, which is a high cost of drug prices and the high cost of hospital care. And these guys keep these prices inflated because they make tons of money doing this. And that collusion takes place between the lawyers and lobbyists in Washington and the health insurance companies. That's what's actually going on.
And the hospitals.
This is a root cause. In engineering, everyone flies in an airplane, right? It's a pretty amazing thing. But, you have to address the actual root cause. So we're all sort of dancing around the issues. The real root cause is that the drug development process is an old model. It's about 100 years old. And it's innovation that's going to solve this, not regulation.
Okay. So you said earlier that you're against single-payer health care, but the argument that the left is starting to play and has for a while, is that everybody has a right to health care and therefore the government must provide it.
I don't believe that's true, though. I think people have the right to liberty and freedom, those things. I don't think people have a right to health care. That's not a right.
Okay, so how do you make the case to a state full of liberals that health care is not a right?
Well, look, we talk to a lot of liberals. You know, I was on the phone with a donor who loves Elizabeth Warren. After you heard what I had to say, they donated us $1,000. So let's really understand. Now I'm telling you, let's understand who liberals are. If you take the western part of the state, a lot of people are into organic food, yoga, Kripalu. You know, the earthy, crunchy granola people, right? You know what I'm talking about, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, those people, the arguments that I make, they say, what? Elizabeth Warren voted for the Monsanto Protection Act? Because they know what health care is. Because we know that glyphosate causes fatty liver disease. So what I'm saying is we need to expand what we mean by health care. There's a lot of smart people in this state. They're not just, you know, looking at single payer this. They're looking at health care. The 2.3 million unenrolled people, 1 million people are independents, right? Mm-hmm. There's a set of Democrats who frankly don't like Elizabeth Warren. At least 40% of them we know from the recent polls. Those people are going to be attracted to my candidacy because you can't bucket me. Left or right or liberal or conservative, I'm going to talk about it in a very rational way. So when you take health care to those people, when you say, hey, you know what, Elizabeth Warren voted for the Monsanto Protection Act, what do you think about that? They go, what do you mean? Oh, you know what, she was against GMO labeling. Really? Those are issues conservatives, quote unquote conservatives, Republicans don't even know how to talk about. At the same time, I'm also against the Paris Accords, and I've been able to convince those people why the Paris Accords had nothing to do with, you know, stopping pollution. So that's what I'm able to articulate. That's why whole sets of liberals and independents are going to support my candidacy, because they're not going to support a typical Republican candidate.
Does anybody else have any non-healthcare related questions?
So you made some statements right at the beginning. One was that one of your questions is the Republican Party up to somebody like you as a voting? This Republican Party is up to change in this town. We are one of the few that have a rep that's Republican, although these days it doesn't matter if it's Republican only. But the year before you were in Boston on the Common in the bandstand, I was there reading scripture for 91 hours from beginning to end. So my battle is a little bit different than yours, but it doesn't mean that some of us aren't brave. That's the first thing. And the second thing is you mentioned something about Black Lives Matter and how Jeff Diehl just labeled Black Lives Matter, but I don't agree with that unless you want to expand on what you were saying about your competitor, Jeff Diehl.
What are you talking about?
You said
they're trying to pass a resolution saying Black Lives Matter is a hate group also.
It is.
Well, here's the thing, right?
Antifa
is a hate group.
Yeah,
okay?
It is.
I think that's just my opinion. Well, what I'm saying is, who is this benefiting labeling all these things? It's benefiting who? Jeff Diehl, so he can act as though he's fighting?
No, it actually benefits.
Well, why are we labeling?
It benefits the individual citizen of America, because if there's an organization that's known for violence, we have to identify the organization so that the police are not supporting that organization. Like in California, they let the Antifa go through and beat up the people who are speaking free speech. So it's very important that we label appropriately a violent group. And the Charlottesville issue, those people, I don't agree with the white supremacists, but they have a right to free speech. Those people from Antifa and Black Lives Matter came with bats, clubs, weapons. In Boston, they were smart. They searched everybody for weapons. Unfortunately, they kept them so far away from you, you couldn't even hear you speak because there was but there was no violence.
Right, but what I'm trying to say is, you know, 20 years ago, you used to be able, without a permit, go into Harvard Square, mm-hmm. put up your soapbox, and you used to be able to speak.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So we have a set of people now dictating to other people that by labeling people that they know better. You see, this is a very... Let me finish.
I just want to
make this one point. Let me just finish my point. Once you start people labeling thinks, look, I'm attacking the academic elite, and I'm a person of color who has a lot to, quote unquote, lose in this. You're saying these people with these hats, with these two holes in them, and these people have a swastika, by the way, which is an Indian symbol, are white supremacists. Okay, so
I did not say that.
Well, no. I'm saying that's what certain people want to do.
Jeff Dale did not say that.
Well, I don't know what Jeff Dale wants to do because he's an opportunist, okay?
I disagree.
Well, that's your disagreement.
Right.
But my point is, the reality is that to label people denies people the ability for them to make their own minds up, okay? Because this is assuming someone's doing Heil Hitler over here, someone's doing a swastika over here, that I, as a citizen, don't have the intelligence to figure that out. In the old days, someone put out a soapbox, and if they did that, you just walked by them. You didn't throw acid on them. You didn't throw urine at them. You just walked by. And so if we're starting to create a society now where we start labeling people, which could be, by the way, good to people of color, so you don't have, but you're creating a certain society which is based on going down to the lowest common denominator, which is not trusting people's ability to make their own decisions.
I just have a comment back.
One more comment, and I need to move on.
Yeah,
and then
that's
we
okay.
Need to move on with
yeah.
So, Shiva, if you had been in Boston, because you took your permit out in July, and the Charlottesville incident happened after that, so if
I
you,
didn't take out the permit, but
well,
I was invited.
Well, the other person
speaker.
Did, yeah.
Yeah.
So if you had been, if the Charlottesville incident had not happened, what happened in Boston with the blockage and the weapons, that would have been completely different. Everybody would have been up close to the bandstand. That would be a non-issue. And sometimes a terrorist group, Shiva, does need to be labeled.
Well, I don't know what you're saying, because it seems like, because the press was not allowed in there, okay?
That's right.
40 of us were in there.
I'm just saying,
right.
No, wait.
That's right.
You are basically defending the state's right to under certain conditions. That's what you're heading towards.
No.
That's a form of fascism.
No, you are.
Because
for the record,
okay.
I did not say that.
Okay, carry on.
I'm not sure what you're saying then.
I'm saying that there was no violence in Boston like there was in Charlottesville. And I'm saying if you had your event prior to the Charlottesville event, what happened about free speech in Boston would not have been the same. The hundreds of people, thousands
maybe,
of people.
But the point is, that's where you test the Constitution, okay, under those circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
And what you're saying is, well, we should forgive them under this condition.
Forgive
and
who?
That's what I...
Forgive who? The Boston Police?
No, not Boston Police did
forgive
their job.
Who?
Marty Walsh and the administration.
Oh, I don't forgive them. They incited the violence.
Right,
absolutely.
In fact, he marched with them.
Yeah, but anyway.
Yeah.
Okay, so I just on a different topic, so I'm just going to fire a few at you. Immigration, what's your position on that, specifically illegal immigration? Abortion, what are your views on that? The Second Amendment, what are your views on the Second Amendment?
Yeah, so let's take each one. So I want to also add a fourth one to that, which is the right to communication, okay, which is part of the Second Amendment. So first one, look, I came here as a legal immigrant. My parents came here first. My dad came here first. We had to wait a year, and then we came. I have some very particular issues. Like, I don't think we actually need the H-1B. I think many of the immigration policies that were put in place in America were basically so the politicians never had to address the infrastructure issues in this country. So, for example, right, the number of illegal immigrants that we have here obviates, particularly the Democrats, for example, having to address the fact that we don't have enough trained, skilled people, indigenous people here. So you bring in people, right, and you can outsource work to them, and those people are always kept in limbo. If you look at the history of Mexican Americans in this country going back to the 1800s, there's always been, frankly, a racist policy towards those people, never giving them full citizenship or not giving them citizenship. It's always been kept in this limbo, and the people who profited from this are very big corporations, when you really look at it, because they've gotten cheap labor out of them. So I think what Trump's trying to do, he's trying to say, look, let's go back to ninth grade civics. The executive branch is for enforcement, the legislative branch is for interpretation of the laws, and Congress should pass laws. And Obama tried to, do his thing so he can get popularity and votes. So what I think, what he did with DACA is right on target with how you should, if you believe in the U.S. form of government. Otherwise, you don't have a government. Either you have legal immigration or you don't.
So you're saying, so should we attempt to stem the illegal immigration? Because that seems to be...
The issue is we have to follow the laws. Mm-hmm. How did we get into this situation where you have sanctuary cities? And either you have laws or you don't.
Okay.
I mean, my dad came here, then we had to wait. So that's one.
So you are on the side of law. I'm just trying.
Definitely.
Okay.
Because otherwise you don't have a country. If you believe in the concept of a nation state, you have to follow through on that. You can't have your own irrational positions as you need because you feel it emotionally makes you feel better and it absolves your guilt of something when you don't want to really address the real issues. The second issue with immigration is, you know what, in when my parents came here, they had to submit their resumes, they had to submit their grade reports, it was merit-based. Because after Sputnik had gone up, you know, we were in the space race. Kennedy wanted more people of, you know, educational background. That's when my parents came. Now, it's an interesting phenomenon. I'm going to argue for something which may seem counterintuitive. In many ways, I would argue what was done there was a policy of expediency, and it never addressed building up the educational infrastructure of this country. So what happened was India got brain drained of 2 million some of the best people. India ended up having a dynastic government, a very corrupt government, because you removed the best minds. So I could argue that it would have been good that my parents did not come, if this makes any sense. Because had they not come, maybe they would have stayed there and fixed their own government. What we do is we don't fix the infrastructure of this country, and we put Band-Aid solutions on it. Right? That's what really goes on, and later we can say it was good, but it really isn't good when you look at it. Even if you want to look at it from a global perspective, one could argue had smart people like my parents stayed in India, maybe they would have participated in the electoral process. A guy like Modi would have come in even, you know, 30, 40 years ago. So I have a very different view of this. You know, I can almost look at it in a very objective way. So that's on that. Second Amendment, it's the foundations of the Constitution. You know, but you know, if you believe the pen is mightier than the sword, if the Second Amendment is a sword, there's something more important which we've all forgotten has actually gotten decimated. It's the right to free communication. I don't know if you know the Postal Service, when it was created, in my view, it's as important as the Second Amendment. When it got created by Franklin and others, the goal was that I could send you a piece of communication at the lowest cost, or anyone could, without any government intervention. In fact, if someone intervened with the postal communications, 20 years life sentence in prison, you know that, right?
Yeah.
The Office of Inspector General got set up for that. When email came, 78 to 92, you know, primarily email was used in the interoffice environment. If you remember we had like Lotus Notes, and you didn't need the internet, per se. You don't need the at symbol, etc. After 92, 93, when the web came, email became a consumer application. In 1997, email volume overtook postal mail volume. I met with the Postal Service then because I was running a different company for email, and I said, you guys should create a public service for email. Why? Because what happened was, as Hotmail, Yahoo, Gmail, all these companies came, most of us got free email accounts. I'm sure everyone here has a free email account. Most people don't read their privacy statements. They own your email. I don't know if you know that. Does everyone know that?
Yeah, we know it.
Yeah, either you have your own server, that's why Hillary got her own server,
yes,
okay? So we're heading into the haves and have-nots, because the have-nots are people who don't have their own server, and the haves are. So what we have now is, following 1997, all of our emails being watched, and, you know, we don't own communication. Up until 1970, 60% of the mail communication was political communication. Right, so the founders of this country knew that communication was as important as the Second Amendment. And what we have now, we've decimated that. And so I have solutions for that. You know, there's some incredible solutions called mesh networks. Telcos essentially own your email too. So we've got to forget it. In concomitant with the Second Amendment is what's happened to our communications. And there's technology innovations which can resolve that. And
then,
So
good point on the...
I can talk more about that.
Second Amendment. But just back to the Second Amendment. Direct ownership of guns, do you...
Yeah, look, most of gun owners...
constitutional carry for the whole country?
Yeah, look, my view is most gun owners are hunters who are very responsible, you know, and, you know, most of the places where they put in these hard gun laws, there's no correlation between that and the reduction in violence, right, like Chicago or Illinois, for example. So I'm a big supporter of the Second Amendment.
Okay.
Fully.
All right. And then the last one was abortion. What do you stand on?
So here's my talk. I have a PhD in biology, and I'm just going to say this one statement on it, but it's pretty clear that life begins at conception. It's a biological fact. Period.
All right.
And so, you know, I don't know what more you want me to say on it. Here's my view on this, okay? That a woman, when people are making this decision, they've always made it one decision. I'm saying there's two lives involved here, whether people like to accept it or not, on the left or the right. Mm-hmm. There's two lives because it's the epithelial forms around this, you know, embryo. It is another life form. And it's living independent, except for that umbilical cord. Right, it is still its own life form because of the distant nature of biology.
Amen.
Period. Right. So my view is that this is a decision that should not be taken lightly. Oh, it's not a life form. It is a life form, and I think it's a decision that I can't make for anyone. But in my view, you know, it is a separate standing life form.
Okay. So there's a petition that's just starting to amend the Constitution. To say that the Constitution does not require public funding for abortion. So if that got to the legislature and you were the legislature.
I don't believe that we should be, I don't think this should be publicly funded.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
Mark?
Paul took my thunder on one of the issues. But I do have a question. I've been reading a little bit lately about some of these high-tech companies like Google and Facebook now have literally grown so large and so massive.
They're
not controlling such vast quantities of information and content out there. But they really established monopolies on this. And now people out in Silicon Valley, out in California, are now making judgment calls on content. People that are posting certain types of messages, certain types of people, they're basically making you know, deleting. I read somewhere recently that Google is deleting over a million items a day of content. You know, just on their own judgment call. They're now controlling. You know what the masses see in terms of the content. And, you know, I started to see a little bit about. Some are arguing that these companies have really gotten too big, and antitrust laws should be used to try to break these companies up. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I do. So look, this comes back to why we can't have career politicians in there. You need to have people actually understand the modern world. We're in the 21st century, going to the 22nd century. When you look at the new technologies like 3D printing, there's huge IP issues that are going to come up there. But if you've never done that, you're just going to rely on consultants. If people didn't understand content and distribution, for example, I'll give you, remember when I talked about the invention of email? In 1976, there was no laws to protect, in 1978, no laws to protect software. I don't know if you know this. People thought the only law that existed was the Copyright Act of 1976, which let you use, you know, for a novel, you know, you wrote a piece of music. In 1980, the politicians in Congress amended the Copyright Act of 1976 because they thought software was sheet music. Okay? So they said, oh, we're going to allow copyright to protect software. Now, there's a problem with that, because copyright only protects a literal work. So when I copyright an email, it protected that literal work. But that was the only vehicle I had to protect software inventions. It didn't protect all my ideas. That's why I don't make a penny off of it. Okay, unless someone exactly copied my code. In 1994, the Federal Court of Appeals, 15 years later, said, oh, software is a digital machine. 15 years later, and I couldn't patent then because there's prior art. The point is, when you have politicians who've never fixed anything, they don't know what an aircraft, you know, all these technologies, which was what the founders knew, they created laws. You know, Hamilton knew the financial system. The guy created it. So he knew how to create laws. So we have politicians who are removed from the actual production. So when you bring up something like Facebook and Google, because they don't know what a network is, because they don't understand content management systems, they have no idea of how pervasive these things are. Those of us, you know, at the Media Lab, where I got one of my masters from, knew about this coming. So what needs to happen is some of these things perhaps should become public utilities. Let me also tell you that when the internet got created by the so-called military, which didn't create it, Western Union and Honeywell actually created the first protocols. What happened was the military-industrial complex created one standard for the internet. We should have multiple internets. We only have one internet protocol. There are technologies like mesh networks, which allow you or you to put up a router on your house for $25. We could technically create a public internet, publicly owned, not by the telcos. So we have to really start having people like me in the Senate who completely educate people on what's going on, because Facebook and Google, literally to your point, are manipulating content, can manipulate narratives. Overnight they can character assassinate somebody. Overnight they can change the index of someone, brand someone for being this or that. It's very, very dangerous. And antitrust laws should be looked at, but it may be too late. But it could be that certain types of companies, at a certain point, you know, patent life is for 20 years, certain types of companies should become public utilities after a certain lifetime. But again, this requires people to actually understand technology. But as long as you have lawyers and lobbyists and people can profit from cybersecurity, these issues are never going to come to the forefront. That's why someone like me can articulate this, at minimum make people aware of it. But it's a very dangerous situation right now with Google and Facebook.
Thank you so much for
coming.
Thank you.
We
really appreciate it. You can stay for a meeting if you wish, or...
You want to give 5 minutes off or something?
And we have every question over here.
Maybe you breathe.
Only 5 minutes
off. Yeah, by the way, we have a sign-up sheet here.
Yeah,
it was
right
there. People want to sign up, to be awesome. And I know Preeti and Dr. Tishore passed out some cards.
That's the best guest we've ever had.
I'm going to